Good evening, everyone. Welcome. We are so delighted this evening. I am so delighted to introduce a fantastic film project program. My name is Dinda Elliott. I'm the director of programs at China Institute. And as many of you know, we've launched a series together with Richard Pena of kind of China's greatest films. And we started that a couple of weeks ago with we started this summer with films from the 20s and 30s and 40s. But a few weeks ago showed, you know, the great film from 1984 that came out in China and sort of launched a whole new genre of film, Yellow Earth, and had director Chen Kaige join us for that. So tonight, I'm so delighted. We're absolutely thrilled. I hope you've all had a chance to watch this film called Pickpocket or Xiao Wu, which really captures a moment in time. It's set in 1997. It's against the backdrop of Hong Kong's return to Chinese sovereignty, but it portrays a small town, a small emerging town trying to crack down on crime. And it's about the people who populate that town and are part of that whole initiative. And the realism of this film is absolutely stunning. There's no epic historical drama in it. Jia Zhangke has said that he uses unprofessional, non-professional people, not professional actors in the film. And it's just a bitter look at life during the contemporary life during the reform era of China. So it's an amazing film. And we are so delighted to have the director, Jia Zhangke, join us tonight. Jia Zhangke was born in 1970, and he is really one of the leaders of what they call the sixth generation of Chinese directors. He graduated from the Beijing Film Academy, and his films, his debut was Pickpocket, called Xiao Wu, which I hope you've all seen. But his subsequent films also have been incredible award winners: Still Life, Touch of Sin, Mountains May Depart, Ashes the Purest White, Swimming Out Till the Sea Turns Blue. All of these films have won awards around the world. And Jia Zhangke is really one of the greatest filmmakers in China today. And we are delighted also that the curator of this series, Richard Pena, is joining us tonight, and he will be talking with Jia Zhangke. Richard is a professor of film studies at Columbia University, and he was the program director of the Film Society of Lincoln Center for many, many years, and also the director of the New York Film Festival. Richard knows these directors. He knows Jia Zhangke. He knows Chen Kaige, and it's really a privilege to have the two of them in conversation tonight. So I'm going to turn off my camera and turn over the camera to Richard and Jia Zhangke. Please come join us. We also have Manny Huang, who is an artist herself, but she's going to help us with translation tonight. So Richard, Jia Zhangke, yep. Please come join us. Welcome, Jia Zhangke. We're so, so happy to have you. So very, very honored. Thank you.
I'm
really happy to be here to talk about Xiao Wu today.
Hello again. Great to see everybody in this. And Jia Zhangke, wonderful to see you. I'm sorry we're not in the same room, but at least we can be on the same Zoom.
非常高兴在这里见到你，尽管只是在线上，而不是在同一个房间里。Just
as a little bit of an introduction, a few weeks ago, of course, we had Chen Kaige in this program, and he spoke really eloquently about his work on Yellow Earth, and we tried to really talk about the impact of that film, which was enormous at the time, and it really introduced film from the People's Republic to so many of us.
上一回，对，我们上次和那个陈凯歌有一个对话，然后呢，我们就是讲到了那个他当时的电影是对于是非常有影响力的，是我们美国的观众只是通过这个电影才了解到中国。But
I would say that tonight's film Xiao Wu had in many ways an equally strong impact, certainly on me and certainly on many international audiences, because in fact, it really presented a whole new kind of Chinese cinema.
Okay.
I guess I don't have to have those translated. One that really showed us a much more contemporary look at China, and one that also really began to explore, to my mind, in a very interesting way, ideas like the long take and camera movement and things like that within Chinese film. So Xiao Wu is really a kind of another watershed moment. So I'm pleased we're able to have it in this program and to have Jia Zhangke here with us. So let me begin my questions. As I mentioned a few weeks ago, we had Chen Kai-ge here, and he began the conversation talking about his time at the Beijing Film Academy. Now, he went to the Beijing Film Academy about 15 years or so before you did, but it was a very different time. Can you talk about your work at the Beijing Film Academy and what the Beijing Film Academy was like for you in the mid-1990s?
OK， 那我简单来说一下，那个他们他说到就是他和那个陈凯歌谈到了聊天的时候聊到他在北京电影学院的时光，然后呢，就是他在那个之后，就是十多年前您也去了那里，然后呢，所以说他想让您谈谈您在那里的经历，以及就是你在学生时代所学到的东西。
嗯，谢谢 Richard。我是1993年考到了北京电影学院，那个时候90年代初期，进入北京电影学院之后，我学的是这个文学，也就是我学的是电影理论专业，但当时呢，整个电影的北京电影的学院的这个教学呢，我想可能跟陈凯歌他们那个时代会有些不一样。因为这凯歌导演他们是1978年读的北京电影学院，我是93年。那么从78年到93年呢，有一个很大的变化，就是有更多的来自其他不同地区留学回来的老师开始在北京电影学院教书。因为过去可能在凯歌导演他们那个时候，大部分都是五六十年代留学苏联前苏联的教师，他们回来之后他们的教学体系和观看的影片主要是以前苏联的电影为主。那么到我读书的时候呢，也正好那个时候也经历了80年代之后，有很多中国从法国、从美国、从日本留学回来的老师开始教我们，那样的话它带来了一个更加完整的当代电影的面貌，而不仅仅是只观赏前苏联电影。另外一方面呢，也带回来更多的不同的这个背后的电影文化的这种理论，这是一方面。再一方面呢，
让我翻译一下。So I entered the Beijing Film Academy in 1993.So that was the early 90s, and I studied literature and particular film theory. And the academy was very different then when compared to when Chen Kai-ge was there. So because he was there in 1978 and I started in 1993. The biggest difference was that when I was there, there were many professors who studied overseas, and they started teaching there. And whereas for Chen Kai-ge, his professors were more people who studied in the Soviet Union in the 50s and 60s. So their educational system was much more of, had more Soviet references. But for me, I had professors who studied in France, the US, Japan. So they brought back a different but systematic view of contemporary cinema at the time.
另外一方面，今天回想起来，就是那个时候北京电影学院开始有很多留学生，这个学生跟学生之间的交流又很重要。 我记得当时我们同时在校的大概有三四十个来自意大利、法国、欧洲其他国家的留学生。那这些学生跟我们一起学习呢，他们经常以会我跟我们就是交换各种各样的电影信息。那另外一方面呢，我们的很多老师他们也经常的参加国际电影节。你像这个谢飞导演，我记得这个我们第一次看阿巴斯导演的电影，就是谢飞导演从国外回来之后带回来一个录像带来一起观赏。所以那个时候对我来说，就是从我的家乡山西汾阳一个很小的城市去了太原去了北京之后，你面对的就好像全世界的电影信息量非常大，就说实话一开始有点晕，反正就是不停的在看，不停的在讨论，处在一个那样的一个就是很丰富的那样的一个阶段吧。
OK。Looking back today, there were also many students from overseas. When I was there, there were about 30 or 40 students from Europe. And so we would often exchange information about film and just have conversations. And I remember I had a professor named Xie Fei who also studied overseas, and he brought back a cassette tape of a film director.阿巴斯 是谁？
阿巴斯是伊朗的导演 Kiarostami。
Kiarostami。
Right, so he brought back a cassette tape of this director's film. And me being from a really small town in Fenyang, in Shanxi, and going to a big city like Beijing, and I was exposed to so much film.And that it was, it felt busy, but I was taking in a lot of information.
那另外一个不一样的地方呢，是中国的电影的这个整个经济电影的这个社会结构在改变。凯歌导演他们在学电影的时候，那个时候中国是计划经济体制，也就是说，这个电影学院的学生毕业以后会分配到一个国营的电影制片厂。那么在这个国营电影制片厂，他们经过自己的努力，最终可以会获得拍电影的机会那完全是一个计划经济时代的这样的一个情况。那到我们呢，就市场经济开始活跃起来了，就是我们已经开始没有一个国营制片厂你可以去那你必须要学会在市场里面生存。也就是在这样的一个背景里面，就每个人都是自己来选择工作，自己来想自己的这个出路，他不像过去是被分配到一个地方，他激发了我们的一种自由活力也因为这样，就是从九十年代开始中国有了独立制片就是我们开始发现电影可以是一个通过一个人的努力可以一个团队一个小组通过市场化的方法来拍摄，而不单单是通过国营制片厂，这个是一个很大的改变。
And another big difference was in the China's economic structure. When Chen Kaige was working, he still operated under a planned economy.So after he graduated, students like him would be dispatched to a nationally owned film production company. But for me, I had to learn how the rules of of a market economy. There's like no national companies that I could go to. So I had to learn how to survive in the market. And that sparked a lot of creativity.And in the 90s, I had to learn how independent filmmaking worked. And, you had to choose your own job.
Let me just mention that anybody who's listening in, if you have questions, please put them in the chat function. And towards the end of our conversation, we'll go through them and see if there are a few, try and get a couple of questions from our audience to Jia Zhangke.Okay, my second question, if you could please, Jia Zhangke, talk about the writing process. So much of Xiao Wu feels improvised, as if everyone is just making it up. how much of a screenplay did you write for the film and how much did you use of that screenplay in actually shooting the film?
Okay. 他说就想让您谈谈您写作过程。
因为他感觉小五的很大一部分都是即兴发挥的，然后里面的很多场景都感觉非常的洒脱。那么这个电影有多少是根据剧本创作的，有多少是在拍摄过程中即兴的那个发挥的？小五这个剧本完全是一个意外，因为那个时候是1997年的春节。 快过春节了，我当时还在北京电影学院读书，因为要过寒假嘛，过寒假要回老家过春节。那个时候我正在筹备的是一个短片，是一个关于年轻人的爱情的短片，它是由这个一对男女一间屋子一个夜晚构成的这样的一个故事。那带着这个计划，这个筹备了一段时间，过年呢我就回了老家。 看我的父母，中国的春节一般是2月份，那么在2月份这个过春节期间呢，看到了这个家乡的这种变化，非常的剧烈，因为我已经有1年没回去了，它的这种变化来自于外部的这种建筑形态跟内在的这种人际结构，外部的这种建筑形态，就我们是一个明代的县城，一些几百年的历史的一个古老的城市，但是那年回去它要拆掉了。 在这种经济化的浪潮之下，城市在改变，整个这些承载着我们记忆的老的房子都要拆掉。这个对于从小生活在那儿的人来说震撼很大，你能看到一个巨大的变革来到了中国最基层的地方。另外一方面就人际关系的变化，你会发现很多人与人之间出现了很多问题，因为整个人和人之间处理人际关系的这种原则在改变。 经济化的浪潮席卷了每个人的做事的方法。所以在这样的一个情况下，能听到吗？Oh, good.
How are you feeling? I know.
Sorry, Aaron. You need to mute your camera. 不好意思。哎，没事。好，我可以继续讲吗？
对，可以。好，另外方面就是人和人之间的这种传统的人际关系发生了改变，在这样一个震撼之下，我就开始着手写剧本。我们是一边写剧本，一边找钱，一边组织团队。我们到，我记得当时是4月份，4月10号左右开始了这个电影的拍摄，在拍的。 这个开机的时候，有一个初稿的剧本，但是在拍的过程中一直在改，直到最后完成它。Okay,
so the script for Xiao Wu was it's almost like it was an accident. So it was in 1997. It was around New Year's time. I was still at the Beijing Film Academy, and we had an upcoming holiday, so I had to return home. And initially, I had planned on shooting a short film. It was supposed to be about a couple that were lovers, one night, the one room. But when I went to see my parents in February, during Chinese New Year's, I was really struck by changes that had happened in my hometown because I had been away for 1 year. So there were external and internal changes. And externally, Fenyang was was a town that was built in the Ming Dynasty. So it had had been around for a couple of hundreds of years. Because of economic developments that were happening, houses were being demolished. So all of these places that held memories for me, it was going through a really big change. And internally, people's traditional relationships were changing. And that was like, that's like affected by the economic change. So because of that, I had started to work on a different script while at the same time looking for funding. I had also started to assemble a team and we started filming in April. And when we started, we had a script, but then it kept changing.
具体来说，这个剧本一开始是出现了一个人物，一开始并没有故事，没有情节，一开始就在我的脑子里出现了这么一个人。他跟我的年纪差不多，他一直生活在汾阳，他面对了这种人际关系里面的变化。具体来说，他面对了家庭跟父母的关系的改变，面对了他跟朋友关系的改变，面对了跟 他的喜欢的这个女朋友的这种情感的改变，那这个电影的一个是从先有了这样一个面对这些巨大的改变无所适从不适应的这么一个跟我同龄的人这样一个人物，我想拍这样一个人物。另外一方面呢，就是整个这个故事的结构就是从这个人物开始进而进入到他的这个社会关系。 就是因为这个关系，人和人之间的关系是中国人内在的一种生活结构。那我也想通过反过来电影呢，也是通过这种关系来看生活的变化，发生了哪些变化。所以它一方面是先有了像一个萌芽一样，像一个种子一样，先有了小五这样一个人物形象。 接下来在结构这个剧本的时候，整个结构是按它的关系来结构的。我最初这个电影的名字很长，叫做这个靳小勇的朋友，梁长友的儿子，靳小勇的朋友，胡梅梅的棒尖，棒尖就是男朋友的意思，叫小五。这个小五这个前面有很多定语，后来因为太长了，我就取消了。但是它是我最初的电影的构思。
So to go into specifics, in the beginning, there was no plot. I just had one character in mind, Xiao Wu. And he was a similar age as me, had lived in Fenyang all his life. And the film was going to be about his, how the way he dealt with changes that were happening. Changes in terms of his relationship to his family, his friends, the girlfriend that he liked, and you know how he internally processed these changes and couldn't get used to them. So the plot really developed around this character, his social network. So in China, like relationships with others really determined your life. That was a big thing. And Jia Zhangke said that the initial title was really long. I didn't catch the specifics, but I think it's just a lot of his different relationships just staggered together.
而且在写的时候，我觉得，它并不单单是说建立起关系，人和人之间的关系。这种关系在那种巨变的年代里面，或者说，就是我观察到的，它是处在一种运动中的。这种关系它怎么在发展，在改变？ 这种我想拍这种运动中的这种关系，所以就是带着这样的一些构思进入到这个剧本的写作里面。当然，当时也有语言的选择，因为总体上当时中国电影都是语言都是采用普通话，写作通普通话表演。在写剧本的时候，我突然意识到我应该用非职业演员。 特别是用他们的母语来演出，用山西话来演出，这种语言的选择呢，一开始只是一种为了追求电影的一种氛围，跟我家乡的那种建筑物它的空气来融合。但实际上最后我发现它很重要在于，当我采用我家乡的语言去写作这个剧本的时候，我进入到一种这个山西人的情感方法，这种思维方法里面，它带给我一种 一种更准确的一种情感的表现的可能性。那这之后我就比较多的一直在用这个方言来写作我的剧本，这是从这个小五开始确立的。
Yes, so with Xiao Wu, I was really interested in observing and filming relationships that were in movement, were in flux. Another aspect of it was language. At the time, Chinese cinema was dominated by Mandarin as a language. You know, people spoke Mandarin and it was like more of a standardized thing. But I realized that I wanted to use non-professional actors and use, you know, for them to speak the original Shanxi dialect. And it had to do with like, you know, it brought him into this kind of like this ambiance or this kind of a state of mind that were more true to his hometown. It allowed him to think more like a Shanxi, like a person from Shanxi, and operate under that emotional logic.
Let's talk a little bit more about the idea of non-professionals. Your film ends with a title saying that everyone in the film is a non-professional, and you would continue to make films often using non-professionals. Can you talk about the difference in directing professional actors, as you've done, as opposed to directing non-professionals?
就是非专业那个演员和专业演员合作有什么区别？就是和比如说和非专业人士合作的时候，您会像专业人士一样指导他们吗？还是一种不同的方式？这些年拍电影，我基本上采用的一个方法就是说，非专业演员跟专业演员他们会在一起来演。 就是很多都是混合的，比如说像这个天注定，这个部影片里面有专业演员，像这个姜武啊、王宝强啊、赵涛啊这样专业演员，王宝强也有很多是非专业演员。我喜欢这样一种混合，而且我相信他们是能融在一种统一的电影观念和电影的方法之下，这种表演是不同的。 这个专业背景的演员是可以融合到一起的，那小武呢是当时都是非专业演员，在指导非专业演员的时候，首先我们要谈为什么要用非专业演员，因为在90年代中国电影荧幕上的表演都是非常夸张的，非常戏剧化的，这个这样一类型表演。 但是我自己在这个形成我自己的电影认识的过程中，可能也是受了像意大利新现实主义的电影，像投资型车人的影响，特别是包括巴赞的理论，那我根深蒂固的，我认为电影它最大的一个魅力就是物质现实的复原，就是对我们这个现实的一种再造。那我希望我的电影有现实感，有真实感，人有自然的面貌，他们像日常生活中我们在大街上看到的所有人一样，有他们的那样的一种姿态。而当时的中国电影的荧幕上基本上是戏剧化的表演，每个演员都很挺拔。 他们的发音都是经过训练的，都有一种非日常的一种表演感，这个跟我的电影的美学的思考是不太一样的，所以那个时候我想我应该用非职业演员，你先翻这些。
OK, so my method in terms of working with non-professional actors that I've come to develop is that I would mix them together with professional actors. So for example, in A Touch of Sin, I had professional actors like Wang Baoqiang and Zhao Tao work together with non-professional actors. And I'm interested in achieving a state of balance between the two. For Xiao Wu, it was all non-professional actors. I want to talk a little bit about why. So in the 90s, Chinese cinema, the acting style was very exaggerated and theatrical. Like all the actors were very trained. They had like a very standardized pronunciation, and that was not compatible with the his sense of aesthetics. So my understanding of cinema, I really prefer to have more realism. Perhaps I was influenced by new Italian realism, like, you know, Bicycle Thief, for example. I was interested in film as like a replica of reality. And I wanted to kind of really create that sense of realness, you know, like, you know, working with people that, you know, that were just pulled, like, as though they were just pulled off the street. Yeah, 你继续。
对，而且可能在当时，我觉得可能，这种飞行员带来的这种真实感，对我来说那时候有一个很大的快感，就是它具有一种叛逆性，它是对于整个中国荧幕那时候那种虚假的故事跟虚假形象的一个颠覆，我觉得某种程度上，我们是用这样的一种姿态。 带来一种新的声音、新的宣言，因为始终我觉得电影它是形象化的，电影的人物，什么样的人能进入到荧幕，它代表着我们的一种价值观，一种思考，怎么说呢？就是 我们就让普通话不标准、走路歪着的、手不停的在晃，这样一个可能在常规的印象里不可能进入到荧幕世界的一个人物，让他登上了荧幕。因为大多数人都是这个样子，我们应该把生活的本质、生活的真实呈现在荧幕上。所以那时候选用飞行员也有 这样的一个巨大的情感的情绪的一种支撑，我们以这样的方法来带来新的声音。Okay, so
at the time, for me, using non-professional actors, it also had in it a sense of rebellion. Was rebelling against the fakeness of mainstream Chinese cinema. Of course, like cinema is a very stylized genre. I would think about who gets to be represented on screen, and how that reflects the value system that we have as a collective. And so using a non-standardized actor that couldn't even walk straight, that had, you know, their own unique mannerisms, they're like one of us. Me choosing to use non-professional actors, it had that emotional aspect to it as well.
当然在指导演员的时候会有很大的不一样。 我觉得和非职业演员相处需要有很大一部分工作是让他熟悉拍摄这个工作，因为一般来说大家对拍摄本身都很警惕，都很紧张，因为毕竟有一个摄影机在获取你的影像，它有很大的压迫性。电影的工作又是一个很高度工业化的，各部门很多，大家协作，有各种各样的口令。 那首先要让演员来理解电影工作，熟悉这个电影工作，让他很放松。那另外一方面呢，就是要我自己是经常要剧组大多数人跟我们请的演员一起相处，一起吃饭，一起打麻将，一起卡拉 OK， 让大家熟悉起来，建立这种信任感。那另外一方面呢，我觉得要观察。 观察这个演员，他能做什么，他不能做什么，因为他不是经过训练的职业演员。我们使用非职业演员，就是因为他自身的魅力，他自身具有的一种人物特点。 那我们就很大程度上是用各种方法在挖掘他本人的魅力。那职业演员，我们可以有很多工作方法，包括写人物分析啊，这个进行设计啊，那其实非职业演员反而是要用创造很多的这种氛围，激发他的想象力，激发他的这种创作的热情，带来一种意想不到的表演效果。
So in terms of my method in directing actors, for directing non-professional actors, a lot of times, a lot of work goes into familiarizing them with the shooting process. Of course, like in filmmaking, there's a camera. When there's a camera in front of the actor, it becomes an oppressive presence. You know, it makes them very aware. And filmmaking is also a very industrialized, streamlined process. You know, you have like a lot of different departments working together. So a lot of the work went into, you know, making the non-professional actors relaxed. You know, like we ate together, we played mahjong together and sang karaoke, all to build a sense of trust. And also, you know, we had to figure out what the non-professional actor could and could not do. You know, using them is to kind of take advantage of their intrinsic charm and their characteristics. And those oftentimes had to be excavated. With professional actors, you know, like you can do character analysis and a whole bunch of other things. But with non-professional actors, it is creating kind of an environment that makes them comfortable and that could subsequently spark their enthusiasm and, you know, better acting.
Well, I agree very much with what Dinda said before about the very powerful realist effect of Xiao Wu. One aspect of that film, and in fact, all your films, that to me seems very artificial and very constructed is your soundtrack. I always admire your soundtracks and the way that you mix street sounds plus, you know, radio announcements, television, and especially pop music as part of a whole atmosphere always to me is a very important part of your film. Could you talk about how you create the sort of soundscapes, the sort of soundtrack for your films, especially this film, of course?
他就想让您谈谈，就是您，在电影中对于声音的使用，以及就是音景，这个音景的构造。就比如说，就是说您在电影里总是会有很多，比如说大街上那种噪音，电视节目的声音，然后呢，还有尤其是您对于流行音乐的运用，想让您谈一谈。
我觉得小五的这个声音系统，它实际上来自于当时中国小的城市，特别是我家乡那样的县城，它本身具有一种声音结构。我觉得这也是拍电影的一种魅力吧。其实平常我自己在街上待着走着，也不会注意到那么丰富的多的声音层次。但是当你去拍电影的时候，在取景器后面看这个世界的时候，你突然日常生活里面被忽视的很多景物被你看到了，它其实一直存在在那儿，只是没有留意。声音也一样，当你站在大街上去这个去为了拍电影去听这个声音的时候，它一下子你会发现，你的耳朵变得非常敏感。具体来说呢，当时在中国的城市，90年代末97年嘛，并没有一种声音管理的意识，所以这个到处充斥着声音。没有人管理这个声音，大街上每个店都在放音乐，每个人说话的声音都很高，汽车不停地在按喇叭，它形成了一种交响啊，就是城市上空飘扬着非常多种声音，那在我们在拍电影的拍小五的时候，我就决定把这些声音 这个纳入到整个这个声音的结构里面。因为在我们在学习电影的时候，我们讲究声音要很干净，这个所谓干净就是说是对白优先的，就你一定要听出这个对白要100%听清楚，然后那相应的为了对白优先呢，环境声啊、动效啊、音乐啊，它可能就相应的要简单减弱，但是在我制作小五的时候，我觉得是环境声优先的，因为对白是这个整体环境声音中的一部分，我们尽量让它听清楚，但是更主要的是不能减弱整个环境这种声音的复杂性，让这种复杂性存在，它像一个交响乐一样，有很多声部，有很多种声音构成的，所以是建立在这样一种现实的声音的声场的这样的一个真实特点上来进行的。
Okay. For Xiao Wu, the soundscape really is based on a small town, like sounds that you could find in a small town. When in filming, you start to notice what is neglected, what you don't pay attention to normally when you're walking on the street. When you listen closely, your ear starts to become more sensitive. And in the late 90s, when I was filming Xiao Wu, there's no concept of a noise control in a city or a town. You could just hear a sound everywhere, like every shop, like all the shops are playing different music. There's like cars honking on the street. It becomes this like this orchestra of different sounds and noises. And so I decided to incorporate all of these sounds into the film. When I was studying film, I was taught to, we were all taught to make, to be very clean in terms of sound. So you would prioritize dialogues. So environmental sound and music, it had to, they were simplified. But in Xiao Wu, I wanted to prioritize environmental sound. And sort of conceived dialogues as a part of the environmental sound, and so I didn't want to reduce the complexity of this orchestra of different sounds and noises.
Could you make Xiao Wu today? Would it be possible to tell the same story, or has China and Fanyang changed so much that it's really a story from 1997 that could not really be made in 2021.
他说您今天还能拍小五吗？就是整个中国和汾阳发生了如此巨变，然后还有没有可能讲同样的这个故事？还是这个故事只是1997年的故事，而不是2021年的故事？
这个故事我觉得什么年代都会发生，就是因为它这个故事的基本的情况，就是基本的这个结构就是在讲人际关系，在讲家庭的关系、情感的关系，这种关系伴随人类，所以每个年代都有同样的一个故事出现，但是另外一方面也很难再有那样的氛围跟气氛，因为人类的沟通交往的方法改变了。那在那个时候，小五的年代，刚刚有了手提电话，还没有移动互联网，没有微信，没有抖音，没有小视频，没有互联网，只是开始有了手提电话，是那样的一个开始。那今天人类这种生活方法改变非常巨大。面临同样的问题，但是采用的情感的表达的方法肯定是不一样了。有可能今天小五去表达他的爱情，他可能不是面对面去说，不是轻轻的触摸，不是唱一首歌，他可能是拿起手机给他放拍一段短视频或者放一首歌。
Okay, the story of Xiao Wu could really take place anytime, or just the story itself. Since you know it is about his relationship with his family, his emotional relationship, But at the same time, it's hard to replicate the environment that he was in at the time, because so much of our communication technology has changed. In the late 90s, you know, we only just started to have portable phones. There was no internet, no TikTok, no WeChat. Mm-hmm. So, you know, faced with the same issues, even if Xiao Wu wanted to express the same thing, maybe he wouldn't have a face-to-face conversation. Maybe he wouldn't try to touch something very lightly. He wouldn't, he wouldn't sing a song himself. He might film a short video and send that to someone, or send a song to someone. So that is very different.
但我觉得可能更大的改变是可能 中国人不像90年代那样对人际关系，对人和人之间的关系有那么巨大的热情和情感的投入了，可能大家都有一个距离，很礼貌，很客气，彼此尊重，但同时呢，也减少了彼此伤害。小五的年代是人们对完全依赖人际关系，完全生活在一种人际关系的一种纠葛里面。 好像仿佛它是生活的全部。今天中国人的情感的世界也在改变嘛，没有那么浓烈了。I
would say the one bigger change is perhaps that nowadays Chinese people have less enthusiasm and passion about the relationships that they have in their lives. People nowadays are much more polite. There's much more distance, and we respect each other. And that does reduce the amount of hurt that you could potentially inflict on someone. But back then, it's like people's lives were completely revolve around the network that they have. As if that's like everything. So that's another big change.
Okay, thank you so much. Dinda, we have a number of questions. So
yeah, should we jump in? Yeah. Sure. Let's jump in with a couple questions. So fascinating, by the way. Thank you so much, Jia Zhangke, for sharing this. I'm gonna combine two questions, just in the, you know, for the sake of time. So one question is, what kind of experiences have you had that inspired you to create Xiao Wu, this character? Did you apply some of your personal experiences into this film? And the question that's kind of similar in a way is, why do you like to depict the stories of people who are in the lower class of society? Do you have any special emotion for that particular group of people?
Okay, 所以说他这个问题有两个部分，第一个部分是，这个您是不是把，任何的您的个人经历作为灵感，来作为那个拍摄小五的这种灵感，就是您的个人经历故事有没有，那个反映在这个电影里面，然后第二个部分是，您为什么一直都是关注社会底层人物的，生活？
第一个问题，我觉得，也不一定是我个人的直接经历，但是，我也是中国，跟所有中国人一样，也是生活在一个巨大的关系里面，那它可能是我同学的故事，可能是我亲戚的故事，可能是我朋友的故事，那反过来，因为中国人人和人之间关系。 非常亲密，这个亲密就表现在有很多，我们会彼此去了解很多对方隐私的部分，甚至侵入到对方的私隐里面。在这样的情况下，它也变成我自己的经历的一部分。但是，当然，整合起这些故事，它还是需要一些对于生活本身的想象，对于人物本身的想象。一开始，这个人物就是想象一个无法适应改变的我的同龄人。 它是由不同的人组成的，但是它最终形成一个人物，它还是需要用一些基于就建立在现实了解的情况下的一种想象力去完成这样一个人物形象。
Okay. I'm just going to translate the his answer to the first question. Xiao Wu isn't necessarily based on my personal experiences per se, but of course I live in a huge network of people. And so, you know, Xiao Wu may have incorporated stories of, you know, belonging to my classmates, my relatives, and other people that I know. And Chinese people are very intimate with each other, sometimes even to the point where you intrude into other, you know, others' lives. So by that, through that, you know, these other people's stories in my life to become a part of my life. And then secondly, of course, like, you know, making the film, it requires imagination as well. And so Xiao Wu is really a composite character based on stories of, you know, people that he knew, and then also him imagining this character that couldn't get used to big societal changes.
说到为什么一直喜欢拍这个普通的中国的民众，它跟我产生拍电影的想法有关，因为我自己就成长出生在一个非常普通的中国家庭，我的父亲是一名教师，我的母亲是国营商店的售货员，我从小生活的环境是一个我们中国人叫大杂院，就是一个院子里有七八户人家，什么职业都有，有工人，有农民，有教师，有这个有自由职业者，无业的人，我就是在这样的环境里成长，是这个环境，人们生活的不容易，社会的每一个变动对我们生活巨大的一种影响，它给了我拍电影的一种冲动，我想把这些故事呈现在荧幕上，让荧幕上有这些人物，展示我们生活的一个位置，这些年一直拍。是因为他一直吸引我，同时，我想我应该忠实于自己吧，因为这是我最重要的一个电影灵感跟冲动的来源，也可以说我对其他的人物的激情，并没有对中国的每一个普通人的热情这么大，它是一个个人原因，
Can you tell us how your films are received?
I think she has ease to translate.
Oh, sorry. Of course. Sorry.
I'll go very quickly.
Yeah.
So the question was why? Yeah. Okay. So his answer is that so I grew up in a very conventional household. Grew up in this courtyard that had 7 or 8 families. And so, you know, like I got to know, you know, I grew up around people that were factory workers, people who were unemployed, people who were teachers. And that environment really influenced me and really motivated me to make films in the first place. It was really important to me to represent these conventional, these normal characters' lives on the big screen. And, you know, I really had to be faithful to myself. And when it came to other characters, I wasn't as passionate. I don't feel as passionate about representing them in my films.
So another question, I know that you have a hard stop at 9:30, so we want to jump in with some quick questions. How are your films received in China? Do Chinese audiences like to watch these kinds of, you know, films about the sort of harsh reality of contemporary life, or do they prefer to watch kind of, you know, fun Hollywood type movies?
他简单的讲一下，就是说，就是您的电影在中国大陆，那个观众是什么样的回馈和反响？就是他们是对于比如说比较普通的这种，这个人物的。生活感兴趣呢，还是他们更喜欢就像好莱坞的那种大片？
在90年代这个电影刚刚被中国观众看到的时候，它呈现出几种截然不同的反应，一种就是非常喜欢，就是突然 就是觉得啊，这样的人物、这样的故事出现在荧幕上，非常非常激动。另外一种就是非常被冒犯，觉得哦，为什么一个小偷可以成为一个电影的主角？那还有一部分就是很茫然，不知道该怎么判断，就好像突然有一段生活出现在他的面前，就是他无法判断一样，更多的是无法判断。我很喜欢这种感觉，因为实际上电影它对我来说，电影并不是下结论、做判断，或者说有一个提出一个明确的一个对于生活的解决方案。电影它就是呈现生活的多样性、多异性、生活的复杂性，我们无法去判断，就是我们最直观、最准确的一种感觉。就像今天我们处在一个这种疫情之下的世界，处在一个巨大的新的可能性里，我们也是没有办法做判断的，这个世界会变得怎么样不知道。那这个影片因为98年开始观众能看到，到现在已经很多年，到今天在中国还有很多人在谈论这个电影，又其中又掺这个又混杂了很多怀旧，人们已经开始怀念90年代了，怀念那样一个没有互联网的时代，人和人人之间那样的亲密的一个年代，很有趣这种变化。
Okay, so in the 90s, audiences had very different reactions to Xiao Wu. And some people really liked it, but some were offended. They were like, oh, why could a pickpocket become the main character of a film? But most people were really just confused. They didn't know how to feel, or they were somehow unable to make a judgment. For me, cinema is really about, is not about like providing clear solutions or, you know, theories or conclusions. It's about representing the diversity and complexity of life. And, you know, I feel like the pandemic is operating the same way, and we don't really understand the direction that the world is going, and we feel confused, etc. And now also, it's been many years since Xiao Wu was made. And so, you know, people are now feeling nostalgic towards it. They're nostalgic towards an era without internet, and when people's interpersonal relationships were much more close and intimate.
I know we have to end soon, but Jia Zhangke, before you go, could you say a few words about the Pinyao Festival, which has just happened? And of course, you were the founder of this film festival.
他就想让您简单的说一句，就是您这个平遥电影节，然后就是因为是您创立的嘛。
平遥电影节今年已经第五届了，我们是一个致力于这个介绍国际年轻导演和中国年轻导演的这样一个电影节。我们有两个重要的节目，一个是叫做卧虎，就是李安导演卧虎藏龙的卧虎，卧虎是国际新导演的展映。另外一个单元呢，另外一个节目呢叫藏龙，是华语中国新导演的展映。每年有很多很多年轻的电影工作者，年轻的学电影的学生，他们在这儿交流，然后被电影工业被媒体了解。今年有11部最新的年轻导演的作品和中国电影，和12部最新的这个国际年轻导演的作品，彼此让不同文化的年轻人了解对方在做些什么，在想些什么。基本上，我们就是这样的一个影展，年轻的有活力的电影节。
Okay. This year is the 5th installment of the Pingyao Film Festival, and it's really devoted to introducing young international directors and young Chinese directors. And so our program for the international directors is called Crouching Tiger, of course, from Lian's film. And then the program for Chinese directors is called Hidden Dragon. And so it's really meant to be a place of exchange and dialogue between these young directors. And this year we had 11 new films by young Chinese directors debut here, and then 12 films by international directors.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. It's so great to see you again, and congratulations on all your work. And please say hello to Zhao Tao from me.
Thank you. 好，谢谢大家，谢谢。
Wonderful. Bye-bye. Thank you. We're so thrilled to have you, and we hope you'll come back again soon. So thank you, Zhangke. I'll just to say a few words after you leave, but I know you have to run now. So 我知道你先你你要先走，所以没关系。Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. 有机会我们再聊，谢谢大家，谢谢，很高兴开心跟大家聊小五，谢谢。
So sweet, he says, you know, we'll continue chatting in the future. Such a wonderful, wonderful guy. So Richard, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
I don't know if you have, you know, any sort of final thoughts about his work that you want to share, because it's so intense. It's amazing.
Yeah. It's amazing to look at Xiao Wu again, because even though it's a first film, it's so incredibly mature. It's amazing how well he already knew what he was doing. I mean, you know, sometimes the joy of a first film is seeing a director kind of in a embryonic state, but he was pretty full born by the time he made Xiao Wu. And of course that style and his approach would only deepen as years went on. But you know, it's really an extraordinary film, and it was great to have the chance to see it again and to think about it again.
Incredible, just absolutely incredible. So thank you, Richard, so
much. My pleasure. Thank you very much, Banyi.
And thank you, Banyi. I have to say, Banyi, that was just spectacular translation. That was really, really great. So thank you. Thank you all for joining. And a couple of other cool programs I just want to call to everyone's attention. You know, in about a month, let's see, what day is it on? In about a month, we've got another film Richard's going to be introducing. And that is Shower, with the director Zhang Yang, and Peter Lohr, the producer, is going to join us as well. So we're very, very excited about that. That's on November 17th. I hope you'll join us for that. And next week, we're doing a really cool, different kind of program, which is about architecture. And it's about China's changing approaches to urban development and how the past is informing China's future cities. So we've got a couple of top contemporary Chinese architects joining us from China, and we've got a couple of China-born professors of architectural history and urban planning here based in the United States. So it's going to be a fascinating conversation about architecture. So please join in. That's next Tuesday. So again, thank you all so much. Thank you, Richard. We can't wait to continue the conversation, as Jia Zhangke said.
Take care, everybody. Good night.
Take care. Bye-bye.